Well, hello again, and it's another opportunity for us to come together and to praise and to worship our God. Thank you for tuning in with me, and welcome to my home. It is good to be with you. You know, we've heard over these past months over and over again how the church is not the building, but that the church instead is the body of Christ to the people. And that's what we study today as we look and see how Jesus Christ himself was so very much for the people, for you and for me. So as we come to worship him this morning, I invite you to grab your scriptures and prepare to follow along. Praise and sing along as our praise team leads us into the presence of Christ, and lift your heart in prayer and just open yourself to all that God would have in store for you this day and beyond. Let's go to God in prayer. Won't you please join me? Oh, loving Heavenly Father, we do thank you for your presence. We thank you for your power, your love. We thank you, God, that you love us so very much and that you are so very much for us. And so, God, we ask that you be with us today as we open your word, as we pray, as we sing praises to your name, Lord God, as we reflect on our own lives and how it is that we can live them more fully and completely surrendered to you for your honor and for your glory. That's our heart's desire today, is to make a Christ difference in the community that you've placed us to minister in, right in the very middle of all the real and true life circumstances that we're all experiencing in these days. Use us, we pray, Lord God, to show this world your power, your might, your glory, your goodness. We ask it all, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Have you ever had one of those days, maybe one of those weeks, even one of those seasons in your life where it seems like nobody really cares? Perhaps you feel or have felt lonely. Maybe you ask why so-and-so hasn't called. Why do you always have to be the one that makes the phone call? I mean, is it just me? What have I done? Especially during these socially distanced COVID days and months, right? We feel some days where it just feels like we want to scream, is anybody out there? I think we've all felt that way at some time in our lives. But you know what I'm going to say. I'm going to tell you that God cares. Well, of course God cares. God is there. Of course we know that. But oh, it sure would be nice if so-and-so would call me, if I could just spend some time with this friend, with this family member. It just would be so good. For the past few weeks, we've been talking about the fact that God is in fact for us. And we asked the question, if he wasn't on our side, where would we be? It's difficult to even think about, isn't it? And then last week, we talked about the fact that God is for us even when we make wrong choices, when we rebel against him, when we are disobedient to him, when we refuse him. He gives us those choices to make, and we make the wrong ones. He, our loving Father, he is still for us. And today, we want to study the fact that he has this deeply rooted, heartfelt compassion for us, his helplessly lost children. So aren't you glad? Aren't you glad? Imagine if he wasn't for you. Aren't you glad that he is? Where would we be if for some reason he wasn't? And so in today's scripture, we step into what seems to be a routine day in the life of Jesus and his disciples. It is somewhat early in Jesus' ministry in Galilee, and he's called his disciples to follow him. And he begins teaching them and preparing him for their very mission in this world. And so I invite you to turn to Matthew's gospel this morning, to the 9th chapter, and we'll look there together at Matthew 9, beginning with verse 35, and we'll read together and study together verses 35 through 38. Matthew 9, 35 through 38. Please grab your scriptures and follow along, won't you? And then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." One way that God shows that he is for us is when he shows us others who are for us. For those people who do not know Jesus Christ, he shows them that he is for them when we show them that we are for them. You as a Christ follower, how you live your everyday life in your, right in the midst of your very real, true life circumstances, whatever those circumstances are, that is what other people see as the light and the love of Christ. When they see you and me living out life right here through COVID, in COVID, perhaps being touched personally by this pandemic, when they see us with all of the financial impacts that are going on in our world today by the crazy, wild political and racial difficulties that we see and experience in these days, when the other people in our world, our neighbors, our friends, people around us, within our sphere of influence, when they see that we are living life for Christ and we're doing so in a way in and with and demonstrating the love of Jesus Christ, that's when they begin to understand and to see that God is actually for them. He is for them because we show them that we know he's for us and that we ourselves are for them as well. Jesus demonstrated to all of us how to do just that. And we see that in these verses today. In verse 35, it says that Jesus went about all the cities and villages, to all of them. All people were precious to Jesus. The people that lived in the larger, wealthier cities, the people that lived in the smaller, remote villages, Jesus cared deeply for them, and Jesus went to them. Jesus just didn't simply hang out in his own domain. Oh no, he crossed cultural and social and even religious barriers. Jesus went. He went to the people. He didn't stay put, and he wasn't concerned in the least about his own comfort. He had a calling and a mission, and that was to bring wholeness to the people, wholeness to all people. And living surrendered and obedient to God, that is wholeness. And in the midst of his going and his teaching and his preaching and his healing, that's what he taught and that's what he desired for all people, is that they would live surrendered and obedient to his heavenly Father. Because Jesus knew that was wholeness for them. That's wholeness for you and for me. And so Jesus went. He went after them. No moss grew under Jesus's feet. Oh no. He was so very much for them that he went after them. He is so very much for you and I. He comes for us as well. Aren't you glad that he pursues you? I mean, just imagine where you'd be if he didn't. You know, God pursued me. He has been pursuing me over the course of my life. I was blessed with parents who cared deeply for God, had a relationship with him, who had a deep relationship with his body of faith, the church. They took us, their children, to church. They taught us the importance of living for and loving Jesus Christ. I had grandparents who did exactly the same, who prayed deeply over all of their grandchildren, longing for them all to surrender their lives to Christ, because they knew that when we did, that we would be okay, because God would be in us and through us and with us. I can remember how God pursued me through the likes of people, other adults in my life as a child. I can remember Ms. Bradley sitting in that little sunbeam class where she would sit in one of those little kitty seats as we all sat in a circle in those same chairs, and she would break open the Word of God and teach us all those stories that she dearly loved, taught us what they would mean to us. And we might not have fully understood it at the time, but I treasure now as an adult what Ms. Bradley did for me. I can remember Mr. Munn as a teenager. Mr. Munn teaching us guys sitting in a classroom there in the church, and him talking about things that we never thought we'd talk about with adults. Certainly not our parents, much less one of the leaders in the church. And yet, with compassion and caring and love, he shared deeply from the scripture and from his own heart and his own life experience. And he taught us and he helped us to open up and to share and to really welcome Jesus Christ into our life. Pastor Logan was my childhood, teenager, early adulthood pastor. Oh, how I loved him so much. He baptized me. Pastor Stewart was the one who took his place when Pastor Logan retired, and he came along, and he was the one that married Rhonda and I. Meant so very much to our family. And then there's Pastor Temple. Oh, what a man of God he has been, a treasure to my wife in her early years, to our family. What a mentor and example to each and every one of us. We even named one of our children after him because he was so and is continually so special to us. He shines the light of Christ into our lives, and he proves to us that God is for us and that he pursues us. I have an amazing wife who loves the Lord and loves to share what God has given her for his glory and his goodness. And she does that in her special and unique way. And she ministers to families throughout our community. And God screams to me at how much he is for his people and for me personally in how he works in and through her. There was a woman in Atlanta. Her name was Kay Keener. And oh, how she touched the lives of our family because she was so deeply, deeply devoted to God. She gave her very all despite whatever life obstacles she had to deal with and lived through. She still lived for Him. And she was one who spoke honestly and lovingly to me and to my family. And I'll never forget struggling through a call into full-time vocational ministry and how Miss K was the one who helped me see some things that I just had the blinders on to. She was so good, and I love her so much for it. God pursued me through her, and I'm so grateful to Him for that. Our grown children talk about their love of the Lord. We see them serving Him in their various and different ways. And when we have issues that come up in our family and we discuss those issues together as a family, and I hear these words of godly gospel truth coming out of the mouths of my grown children, I just can't help but to be in awe of God and celebrate His goodness and recognize how amazing He is to pursue me and to show me that He is for me through them. When I look at you, my church family, and I know I'm so blessed and honored and humbled to be a part of this family who loves God so very much. And I thank Him for how He has used all of you in various ways and in various seasons of these past 18 plus years of my life in this church family to touch me and to speak to me and to pursue me through you. And oh, our praise team, and how when they open their hearts and their spirits to just lift their voices in adoration of God, they take us right into His presence, right to His throne room every time. And I thank God for them because He has pursued me. He has shown me He is for me through them and through so many, many others in our church family and in my life. God just keeps pursuing me through all of you and through so many others. He keeps pursuing us. He has called us out of our darkness, hasn't He? And oh, He has saved me. He has saved us from ourselves many times over and over and again, right? He keeps reminding me that He is for me through others like you. And He does the same for you because He is for you. And He continues to pursue you just like Jesus went out. God comes out. He sends others out to pursue you in His name. What's your story? What's your story today? Who has He used to remind you that He is for you? Who is God using today to remind you that He is for you? And oh, aren't you so glad that He does? I'll ask you today, and I ask myself the same question. Are you going out? Or are you just kind of hanging out and staying within the church family or your own home? Now, I understand, of course, in the times that we're living in and the social distancing and quarantining, that we have some extra COVID challenges amongst us. I understand that. But we need to get creative in our going out in the name of Jesus and going out and helping others to understand that He pursues them as He uses us to demonstrate the love of Jesus Christ for them. So we've got to get creative. Yes, there are times when we might carry on a lengthy conversation with our neighbors when we took the trash out or walked the dog. And these days, maybe we have to do so from across the street instead of right up and with one another. Maybe instead of inviting the neighbors over for coffee or dessert, maybe in these times, this is a time when we can order out as we are probably doing anyway and get an extra meal for that person, that neighbor, the person up the street that lives alone and needs the loving touch of someone who loves Jesus Christ so that they can see Christ in them. Maybe it's phone calls or text messages or handwritten notes. I realize those things are somewhat a thing of the past, but imagine going to your mailbox and getting a personal note from someone that expresses their care and concern for you. That goes a long way for demonstrating the love of Christ. Valentine's Day is coming up. Maybe some special treats. And again, with COVID, maybe the whole Making them yourself might be difficult. Maybe we have to purchase them, but certainly a homemade Valentine would go a long way. Candy from the candy store or the grocery store would make a big difference in somebody's life. We've got to just get creative to be His love for them and to them so that we can show them that He, God, is for them. But we have to take care that we don't let our own comfort get in the way. Are we more concerned about our own comfort than being a Christ influence over those who are lost? Are we more concerned over our own comfort than being concerned about the darkness that they are living in? Are we more concerned about our own comfort than the eternal hell that they are facing? We see in verse 36 that Jesus saw the crowds. He saw people, not just the mass of people. He saw the individuals. In the Greek, that word saw also translates as perceived or experienced or realized. Jesus grasped the reality of the very individual souls that he was seeing. He got it. He got them because he was for them. And so he went and he saw them and he touched them, literally and figuratively. You know, the crowds might put you and I off, but not so with Jesus. He welcomed the crowds because in the crowds he saw the people and he saw them all. Aren't you glad that he sees you? He sees you. He knows you. He gets you. He knows when you're hurting. When something has happened in your life that gives you some sort of physical pain or emotional pain, distress upon your life, he knows. He knows when you're hurting. He knows when you're stressed. When the financial pressure is bearing down on you in the days that we are living through, when there are difficulties in relationships, when you're trying to manage your job in a whole new way and keep your family whole in a whole new way, and to do all this under new constraints and challenges and difficulties, God knows. God knows your stress level. God knows when you're exhausted, when you just feel like you can't put one foot in front of the other, and you so desperately need to crash, and yet when you do, you just can't sleep, you just can't cut your mind off, it's racing all the time. God knows because he sees you. God knows when you're overwhelmed and you feel like, I just can't take this anymore. He knows, he sees you in that situation and in that circumstance. God knows that you know that he's all powerful and in control, but he also knows that you feel like everything seems to be falling apart. He knows you. He knows you better than yourself because he sees you. Aren't you glad that he does? Do you see people? Do you see beyond their outward facade? Can you see through whatever mask it is that they are wearing? Do you really, truly see your spouse and the difficulties that that spouse is dealing with in daily life? Do you really see all the members of your family, or are we running a little bit too fast? Do you see others? When we follow Christ, when we know him, when we know that our personal identity is in him, I believe that the Holy Spirit empowers us to see beyond the earthly, beyond what it is that we can touch and that we can feel, and that he enables us to see the spiritual. And what I mean by that is I believe that when we are surrendered and submitted our lives to the Lordship of Jesus Christ, that his Spirit dwells within us in a way that makes it capable for us, that it equips us, enables us to be able to see and interact with other people and to recognize beyond what they present to us that we can see through to the spiritual needs that they have. I mean, just think about some of the conversations that you've had with people And you're, when we follow Christ and love him, I believe that he shows us that we can see through some of the words to what the depth of the spiritual needs might be there. He helps us to see as well. And that just opens up all manner of opportunity to be the loving presence of Jesus Christ, to have a Christ influence over others. Can you see? Because Jesus teaches us. He teaches us why this seeing is so very, very important. In verse 36, we read that Jesus had compassion for them. He had empathy and concern for all the people that he was seeing. And his compassion, it was not a patronizing one. He was not looking down on them in pity. His seeing and his compassion was not shallow or sentimental. It wasn't charity for them. His compassion was an extreme affection right from his heart. It was his compassion, was his desire that all would know him. His compassion that all would live surrendered to his heavenly Father. His compassion was sincerely and deeply felt. And his compassion came with a price. It cost him his very life for you, for me, for all. Aren't you glad that he has compassion for you, even you? And even me. Do you ever wonder how could he keep loving us and have this compassion for us when we can be so unlovable? Do we have sincere and life-defining compassion for others, even those that are so unlovable? You know, our Christ compassion for them, for others, in our world, in our sphere of influence, it should completely astound them. They should wonder, why? Why is he, why is she doing this for me? Why do they care so much? Why is it that they have this desire to show me, to demonstrate, to love me this way? Our compassion for them should completely astound them. Who in your life is totally dumbfounded by your sincere and true compassion for them? You know, because Jesus sees, he also knows, doesn't he? He knows. In verse 36, he knows, he knew that they were harassed and helpless people, like sheep without a shepherd. He knew they were troubled, they were wearied, they were badgered, they were bullied. In the Greek language, that sense of helplessness also translates to being cast off, to being thrown down. It's not that they just could not do for themselves. In addition, they were abandoned. They were deserted. They were left high and dry. They were vulnerable. They were defenseless, like a sheep without a shepherd. We see references to that very metaphor, if you will, throughout scriptures in both the Old and the New Testaments, of people that are lost in worldly darkness, being just like a sheep without a shepherd. And so often pastors take that expression in those scriptures and talk about the issue of sheep and how sheep can be some of the most dumb, ignorant animals on the face of the planet. I myself have done this many times as well. And it's true. Sheep have vision issues that prevent them from being able to have the kind of peripheral vision to see what's right before them. Their senses aren't what the senses of other animals are. And so predators can come upon them and they become instant prey for those predators. There are stories and stories of sheep that walk to the edge of a cliff and not even realizing or understanding that the ground stops right there before them, and have so often walked off the cliff to their death and their demise. And so, yeah, sheep can be dumb and can do things that are just ridiculous. But here's the truth. What difference does it make? What difference does it make if they're the dumbest animals ever? If they have a good shepherd that cares for them and loves them and protects them and watches out for them, then they'll be okay. They'll be all right. And the same applies when we take that metaphor towards ourselves. I look in the mirror all the time and I think, what are you thinking? Why did you do that? What a dumb decision you made. What a stupid thing you said. And I recognize that left to my own devices, God only knows where I'd be and what I'd get myself into if he weren't there, if he weren't the good shepherd that cares for me, that protects me, that steers me in the right direction, that uses other people like yourselves to prove to me that he is for me and shows me the right ways to go. Yes, we can be stupid, we can be dumb, we can be misguided and absolutely helpless, but it's okay to be so when we have the amazing shepherd that we do in Jesus Christ, because he is for us and he will show us the way. He knows we're helpless and lost, and it breaks his heart that we are. And his heart's desire is that we all, every one of us, turn to him and trust him as our shepherd, as our personal savior. You know, the helpless in our world are those that are living in very deep darkness, that cannot find their way. And many of them are living in such extremes, in the depths of addictions or wicked, evil lifestyles. But also, the helpless are those who are good-hearted and kind and generous and serving in civic organizations in their communities and always helping their neighbors, but they're living in darkness because they don't know him. No matter how good a life they're living, they're in darkness because they haven't given themselves over to him. And it's those extremes and everyone in between that doesn't know him. They're living in darkness. And our darkness, their darkness, the depth of that darkness is irrelevant. It's just the very fact that they or we are even living there. And God knows. He knows we're helpless. Author Anne Lamott has said, "It would help if we all would admit the three most terrible truths of our existence. One, that we are so ruined. Two, oh, that we are so loved. And three, that we are in charge of so very little." I find those to be very, very truthful things, don't you? Aren't you glad God, our Heavenly Father, knows just how helpless we are, and that he so much is for us in our helplessness? I encourage you to read Luke chapter 15, a beautiful, beautiful scripture, and it tells some parables that are absolutely amazing and such strong truth of God's knowing us, seeing us, longing for us, pursuing us, being for us. Luke tells us of the shepherd who has 100 sheep. One is lost. All of a sudden he takes a head count and he can't find the one. And so he leaves the 99 sheep and he goes in pursuit of the one that is lost. The world would scream at us, "Hey, it's just one. You've got 99 others. Don't jeopardize them while you go after the one." But the scriptural truth is that God knows he's got the 99. It's the one that his heart is breaking for. And so he goes after the one sheep. He finds that one sheep, brings him back to the fold. And then there's a celebration. His heart rejoices that he's found the one. There's the story, the parable of the woman who's lost a very precious coin in her home. She can't find it. She doesn't remember where she has placed it. She turns her house upside down, looking everywhere, under every place, every corner, every crevice, everywhere, looking for that coin. Finally, after this long search, she finds the coin and she holds it up and she rejoices that she has found it. She is so excited and she calls all of her friends to tell them, "I found it, I found it, you won't believe it, I have found it." God does the same for us when he finds us, when we find him, when we finally surrender ourselves to him after he has pursued us the way he does. He rejoices. He rejoices that we've come to him. There's the story of the prodigal son, where the father grants the inheritance to one of his sons who has requested it for him. That son runs off with his inheritance too early in their culture to do so, but he does so. And he just squanders away everything that his father has given him. He lives all this wild, worldly living, and then he finds himself with nothing. And he's left in the depths of despair, doesn't know what to do, doesn't know how he's going to provide for himself at all. And finally, somehow, he comes to his senses. "Let me go back. Let me go back to my father." He makes his way home, and he sees his father from afar off. And when he does, he recognizes, in anticipation that his father will be so very angry at him for what he has done, how he's disappointed him, how he's let him down, how he's made all the wrong choices. What he sees is his father's extended arms. And he races to his dad and they embrace. And the father throws a party. He kills the best calf. They have a feast and a celebration, invites all the family and neighbors around and says, "Yes, the one that was lost is now been found." God pursues us. He knows we are helpless and he longs for all of us to come back to him, to be in right and reconciled and restored relationship with him. Do you know the darkness that's around our community, your world, where you live? Do you know the lostness that's there, the helplessness in the people that live right around us, the people that we see, interact with on a daily, weekly basis, how far away they are from God? It's a harsh reality. And even in our sweet little community of Deland, there are people right around us, right up the street from us, that are living in the depths of despair and in true darkness because they don't have him. They're helpless. God knows that. We need to know that. We need to know that so that we too can share the love of Christ with them, show them that he is for them because we are for them. In the last few verses, 37 and 38, that we studied together this morning, we see that Jesus called the disciples, he calls them, he calls us to labor, to work, to shine his light in the very darkness, to be the loving presence of Christ, to point others to Christ as they see the love of Christ right in us. That's his calling to them. That's his calling to us. And that's our life mission, right here at home and beyond. We know this because Jesus himself, he said so. Later in Matthew's gospel, in the 28th chapter, beginning at verse 19, Jesus said these words, "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always to the end of the age." Aren't you glad? Aren't you so glad that he is for you? Aren't you glad that he knows you, that he sees you, he recognizes your helplessness? that he pursues you? Aren't you glad that he is for you? Who is it that you know today that needs to know that God is for them? And what are you going to do about it? Won't you please pray with me? Loving Heavenly Father, we do thank you for the truth of your word. God, we praise you for who you are. And God, I ask, as difficult as it might be for us sometimes, that you give us sight to see those around us who so much need you, that are living far from you, that are living in darkness. No matter how good they may appear to be living and what good, clean, and wholesome lives they might be living, they're living in darkness, Lord God, if they don't know you and haven't surrendered their lives to your goodness and your lordship, Father. Help us to see them. Thank you that you have pursued us in ways that help us to know that you are for us, and God, that you have given us opportunities, Father, to surrender ourselves to you. We praise you that you continue to welcome us into your loving and open arms each and every time, each and every day, when we make mistakes, when we live according to your word, and in times when we don't. But God, I pray that you would help us to take seriously your call to mission, your call, your command, Lord God, to be the presence of Christ to others, to help them to see that you are for them as well, to help them to benefit from and to live in, to experience all that we have, to encounter you as we have encountered you. God, give us a burden for them. Help us, Lord God, to feel so compelled and so enthused and so anxious to show them how much we are for them, because in doing so, we pray that they will begin to understand and to realize that you, God, are for them. And it is the love that comes from you, the love of Jesus Christ, that we exhibit and that we live in and live through and live for them. Oh, how we celebrate, Lord God, that you will bring them right into the fold, right into your family, right back to you. And we praise you for it. Use us, God, today. We pray in the precious and wonderful name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. We ask it all. Amen.